everyone, it's Vanessa. I'm here today to wrap up all of the fiction books that I read in the month of May. Before I start, I just want to say it's really strange to come back here and more Black lives have been lost, more Black people have been killed in this country that still has not been able to look at itself in the face and recognize the entrenched history that we have when it comes to racism and discrimination and prejudice. So I will, of course, leave some links down below. Personally, I've donated to bail funds in the Denver metro area, and I went to a peaceful protest on my day off on Monday. I'm just trying to keep myself as educated as possible. It feels like I continue to read books about inequality and systemic racism, and the books just keep coming, but change doesn't come, it doesn't happen. I've made one video at least about this topic before. I'm always up for reading more books by and about Black lives. So if you have recommendations of things that you think would be up my alley, let me know. Make sure that you look at the links down below if you want to contribute in any way, and I'm happy to have a chat in the comments as well. I'm going to talk first about the JF that I finished in the month of May, so all of the juvenile fiction kids books that I read. A lot of these I had a really good time with. I think overall my month wasn't perfect reading wise. I don't think I fell in love with anything until right at the end of the month, something that wasn't even on my TBR for the month, so that's usually what happens, huh? So I'm gonna go through JF first, then I'll talk about the one YA that I read, and then one adult fiction that I read. The first JF that I read is Efrén Divided by Ernesto, Cisneros. I've been hearing a lot of buzz about this book, and I've heard the author speak at a few virtual conferences in the past month, so I was very excited to get to this one finally. I listened to it on audiobook, and the audiobook experience was amazing. The thing that will stick out for me in this book that just gave me all of the feelings is the main character talking about his mom and thinking about her caresses that she gives him. And this spoke to me a lot and made me feel all of these emotions, because it's the same term that we use in my family to talk about those little caresses. So they call them piojitos, and they're basically little tickles that anybody in your family that cares about you gives you. They're like little caresses. They calm you down. They relax you. A lot of the times you get piojitos to go to sleep. It made me text my mom right away, and like I showed her a picture of this book and I was like, they're talking about piojitos. That it was really, really sweet. This, if you haven't heard of the story, about Efrén, who is dealing with his mom being taken by ICE. Efrén, who is the oldest of three, is basically in charge of taking care of his two younger siblings, as his dad is taking on more hours to be able to continue providing, to then try to get his mom to come back to the United States. It really talks about that struggle of using any means to keep your family together, and it's a very timely, of course, discussion about putting kids in cages, you know, building a wall and all of those things. So definitely recommend this. Definitely had great discussions. The next book that I read, I also listened to on audiobook and I quite liked, and that was Black Brother, Black Brother by Jewell Parker Rhodes. This is a book about two brothers, one who is lighter skinned and one who is darker skinned. It's about kind of the very different lives that these two brothers lead because of their difference in skin tone. The darker skinned brother is the one that we're mostly following, and he becomes involved with a mentor and learns about fencing at their local like YMCA type gym. Basically that teaches him ways of how to deal with the, you know, microaggressions and the outright discrimination based on his dark skin that he feels at his school. I really enjoyed the discussions that all of that brought. I especially love the relationship between him and the mentor. I love the parents too. I felt like the parents were really present in this book, and I love whenever juvenile fiction books do that. So I really enjoyed this book, and I also do recommend it. The next one that I finished was a graphic novel that I read on my tablet, which I'm not 100% used to, so I'm glad to be able to get graphic novels again from the library. I finished the I Survived graphic novel, which is an adaptation of the first I Survived book into graphic novel format. The look of it is very like historical. I think it fits very well with the story. This one is about the sinking of the Titanic. It has a lot of historical facts that I think would be very interesting to kids, especially in a graphic format, and I'm happy to have read it. Definitely one that I will be recommending to kids. My library, I asked them to buy it, and they ended up buying 20 copies of it, so I'm ready to recommend it to kids for sure. The next one that I read after that, I listened to the audiobook of it. I had the ebook version, but then I heard that Danny DeVito was going to be narrating the audio, so you know that I waited until the audiobook came out, and that is The One and Only Bob by Katherine Applegate. This is the second book in that series, kind of like a companion novel to see the world through Bob's eyes, and Bob is the little stray dog that usually sleeps on Ivan's stomach. So if you read The One and Only Ivan, this is something to keep in mind if you would like to learn more from that world. The things that I really enjoyed about this is the humor. Bob is by far the funniest from the whole bunch. I feel like Ivan is more serious, and I feel like Stella and then the new elephant Ruby are more like cute and sweet. Bob is more like wry humor and yeah, sarcastic. I feel like The One and Only Ivan hit more emotionally than this one did, and the majority of this has to do with like a big storm that happens and then them trying to all save the animals that were caught in the storm. A lot of that focused on that, and I didn't really anticipate that that's what the story was going to be about, but I did overall enjoy this and also would continue recommending this series to kids. After that, I finished a graphic novel that's taken me a long time to get to. I think I took this out before we had the closure from the library because of COVID, and it's Queen of the Sea by Dylan Meconis. This is a basically retelling of Queen Elizabeth I of England. It's set off of an island that's basically kind of like an exile island where the crown sends like people who have messed up or have defied the crown. We're following this main character who is a very loyal and courageous little girl. As new people come to the island, she becomes friends with them. She kind of has relationships with them. People leave and then new people come in. She starts learning more about her background and the reasons why she's been exiled to this island. I enjoyed this. I think that it's very dense for a middle grade audience. It's got a lot of history, and a lot of the pages have very dense text, as you can see there, where they describe like a lot of history or background knowledge that you need to know. So it's less dialogue heavy than it is, you know, exposition, which could be a little bit more difficult for kids. So I would recommend this to older kids and to kids who enjoy historical fiction and like completely getting lost in a world, because this is what this book really excelled at. I guess at the end I'll go through my ranking of all of these and tell you like my star rating, because I think that also might help you. The next book that I read, I'm looking over to see the order, is this one, The World Ends in April by Stacy McAnulty. I was really excited for this book. I mentioned it 2 videos ago where I said The Miscalculations of Lightning Girl is my favorite, one of my favorite middle grade books that I've ever read, so I was excited to read more by the author. This book has a lot to do with anxiety and sources from the internet and what sources you can trust, dealing with the feeling of everything is kind of falling in on you and the world might end, and what can you do to prepare for that, and the anxiety that that might cause young people. It's an interesting book because it uses that, but then it also uses like a club that starts meeting to prepare kids for the end of the world based off of a kind of phony, kind of questionable news source that she's getting from the internet. I thought that this book, the plot and the ideas that the author was going with were a little bit different than you see in your typical middle grade book. I really enjoyed the relationships between the main character and her friend, and the main character and her dad, the main character and her grandfather, who's kind of a prepper, but overall, the main character in general didn't speak to me in the way that the main character of The Miscalculations of Lightning Girl spoke to me. I would still recommend this. You know, if you like contemporaries, this was an enjoyable one. After that, I finished a book that I also started on ebook and took me the longest time to finish. I even waited for the audiobook at the end, and then when I got the audiobook, I just listened to the last 3 hours of the audiobook straight and finished the darn book. Thank you, audiobooks. And that is for Echo Mountain by Lauren Wolk. This is the first Lauren Wolk that I've ever read. It's her new release. She's a very hyped author, I feel like, in the middle grade sphere. I keep hearing her name. I keep seeing her book covers. So I was excited to get to this one. This is a historical fiction set in the 1930s, kind of during the Great Depression era, as people are losing their jobs, and so this family moves to the mountain, Echo Mountain. It's basically about their survival in the mountain. It has to do with family and kind of the changing dynamics of family as they're trying to survive, but mostly it's about this main character who doesn't fit into the mold of the girl in the family, and she is much more of a, you know, rough and tumble in the woods kind of a girl than her sister and her mother. And she meets a boy who also lives on the mountain, and meets an older lady who lives at the top of the mountain, and kind of things go from there. You start connecting where people were before they moved to the mountain and kind of how life has changed as a result of them moving there. It's a very sweet tale. It's very slow in parts, and this reads better for an adult reading middle grade fiction than for a kid reading middle grade fiction. So if you know of a kid who likes slow-paced middle grade fiction, this is definitely for them. I personally enjoyed the slow pace of it, but I could see how that could be a little bit difficult for kids just really jive with. After that, I finished a fun, very fast-paced story, which is contradictory to that last one, and that was Ghost Squad by Claribel A. Ortega. I listened to this on audiobook. I was super excited for this book. It's one that I've been looking forward to all year. Again, same with Ernesto Cisneros. I've heard the author talk a lot in the past 2-3 months. She's really been out there like trying to push her book, and I'm here for that. So I want to support, of course, and I really enjoyed this. We are following a main character named Lucelli and her friend Sid as they accidentally like let out spirits and monsters into their town of St. Augustine, Florida. Woo-woo, another book based in Florida. This book is kind of being marketed as Coco meets Stranger Things because like Coco, there's like family members who live as spirits that she still talks to. And like Stranger Things, it has monsters and like spirits that they're trying to fight. It was a really fun adventure story, definitely very action-packed. It was more action-packed than I anticipated. I kind of anticipated this being more symbolic, and I anticipated this being a lot more about an internal monologue of the main character, but really it was more like a ride. It was like a fun ride of them trying to get this all back together in their town. Definitely a fun book that I would recommend to kids, more for younger kids than older kids. Who like these kinds of stories. Definitely would be a great read for Halloween too. Very spooky vibes and nice atmosphere. St. Augustine in general is a pretty spooky town. So after that, I read Framed, which is a toast mystery by James Ponti. This is an author that I've been really looking forward to reading because everything by him has very high ratings on Goodreads, and he's kind of seen as like a very good author for kids who like action-packed stories, similar to Stuart Gibbs and like Chris Gravenstein. So I wanted to read this one to see if this is another series that I could recommend to kids who like those authors. It's a book that follows two characters. The main character is this smarter than grown-ups kind of character who just can see everything. He uses this method called toast, which is the theory of all small things. So he kind of sees the small things and then puts those things together kind of like Sherlock, then can tell you something bigger about the crime or the situation taking place. He teaches this to his new friend in this town that they're in Washington DC. They kind of start solving cases for the FBI and they're in contact with them to help them. This is like the exact thing that I probably would have loved to read as a kid. Like, who does not want to be solving cases for the FBI and like being smarter than grown-ups? That's like every kid's dream probably. I had a really fun time with it. I felt like the mystery was really well put together here. There's kind of twists and turns that I thought were well done in this book. I really like the friendship between the two main characters, and I like the friendship between the main character and the main FBI guy that he's in contact with. It focuses on an art heist, which again is like a nice crime that's like not violent or gory or anything, that's like good for kids who are just starting to get into mysteries too. So I would definitely recommend this to any mystery readers. Okay, after that I finished a book that I don't have, and it's Sideways Stories for Wayside School. The last time I read this I think was in third grade, so it's been a good like 15 plus years. And I read this for my book club that I am doing this afternoon, actually, as I'm filming this. This is a really funny callback to the things that I was reading as a kid. There's definitely some chapters that I remembered more than others. Like, yes, I vividly remember what happens in this chapter. It's just a funny book. Honestly, it is like absurd and ridiculous and silly, but I think that humor really speaks to kids, but it also speaks to me. When I was reading it, I was just laughing. I was chuckling under my breath. I was just like, this is so ridiculous. I hope that we have a great discussion with it later today with the kids, but definitely a fun book that I feel like every young child should read. A book that I did not anticipate to finish before the end of the month because it was actually on my June TBR, but I finished it in the last 2 days. It was Nick Stone's Clean Getaway. This is a book I've been looking forward to for a really long time. Finally got the audiobook. I don't know why I waited so long to read this book, and I honestly thought that it was going to be something different than it was, and I just love this book. Probably my favorite thing that I read all month when it comes to fiction. I think everything just ticked the boxes here for me, and something that I truly connected with and I just wanted more of. Definitely Nick Stone is an author I'm going to check more books out because I just enjoyed my time with this and I really enjoyed the way she wrote this. We are following Scoob, the main character, who is on a road trip with his grandma, who he calls G-Ma. They are going through the American South. When you get started, and this is something that I love in middle grade books, when you get started you don't have very much information, so you're kind of learning and piecing together things about the plot, the characters, how they connect with each other, the conflict that led them to be where they are. You're kind of starting to piece all of that together as you keep reading, and every chapter you just get a little bit more information. fiction. I love when middle grade books do that, and this book did that like the entire time. So they're traveling through the American South on this road trip, you don't know why, and you start learning about the history of the American South. You start learning about identity and racial identity for Scoob, who is a black boy, and his grandma, who is a white lady, them going through the American South and trying to reconcile issues that Scoob is having with his father at home and issues with the grandmother and her husband. It was just lovely, lovely, and I recommend this book to you. Please read it. It was so good. A lot of people kind of talk about how this was very unbelievable to them. For me, I feel like Nick Stone sold all of those things very well to me. I know that things happen in this book that I'm like would never really happen in real life, but I still enjoyed my time with it and the ride with it just because of how Nick Stone wrote it. And then lastly, I just finished, even though it's June, but I want to talk about it, my May wrap up, because I put it in my May TBR. And I just finished Laurie Halse Anderson's Chains. It's been on my TBR for a really long time. It was published in 2008, so probably about as long as that. It focuses on Isabel, the main character, who is sold with her sister to a woman and husband in New York. This is during the Revolutionary War period, where the British are fighting the rebels. Isabel starts getting involved in that because she starts overhearing things in the British household that she is in, and it kind of goes from there. Man, a lot of violence happened in this book that I didn't anticipate. I buddy read this with Amanda at the Curly Reader, and that's kind of one of the big takeaways that we took, is that we did not anticipate this book to be as violent as it was. There's like beatings in this book, there's hangings in this book, there is like fire that like chars people in this book, and branding of humans like Isabel, who is a slave in this time period. I thought that it was very realistic to the time period. You can tell Laurie Halse Anderson really looked into the history. I really enjoyed seeing Isabel's journey throughout all of it. I thought that I would like the characters, especially the secondary characters, more than I did. And I think part of my problem with this is that I didn't have the audiobook available. Therefore, it took me a long time to finish, which kind of sometimes suppresses your enjoyment of a book if it takes you a long time to really get through it. But definitely something that I would recommend if you're looking for a middle grade historical fiction, and just with the caveat that there is violence and a lot of like very explicit descriptions of the violence too. Let's now talk about young adult and then fiction. I only have one of each. I finished Yes, No, Maybe So by Becky Albertalli and Aisha Saeed. This is a contemporary that is very politics heavy. It talks about canvassing between these two main characters. One is a Jewish character and one is a Muslim character. The Jewish character is a young man and the Muslim character is a young woman. They like kind of grew up together but have like grown apart, come across each other again, and then they start canvassing for a political candidate, and then they start talking to people and start seeing things happen in their society that they start believing in this candidate and start believing in the fact that they are canvassing to make change happen. I thought that this book was nice, pretty well done for what it was going for. It is written very similarly in my experience to Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda, which is another Becky Albertalli book. Especially the Jewish boy main character is very similar to Simon in the way he talks and in the way Becky Albertalli really creates her boy and young man characters, I felt are very similar. But for me, that was fine because I did enjoy how Simon came across in Simon versus the Homo Sapiens Agenda. I think some of the discussions in this book are obviously not super subtle, but overall, for what it was going for, I really enjoyed my time with it, with learning about the characters and seeing kind of their evolution and their stepping into politics as a result of them kind of just becoming more educated about the issues affecting their own local community. Okay, so that is it for YA, and then for fiction, adult fiction, the only adult fiction book that I read in the month of May was The Holdout. This book kind of disappointed me, honestly. The reason for that is that was very, very unbelievable to me, the things that happened in this courtroom drama slash like murder mystery slash like thriller. Just some of the things that the main character does and acts on, I feel like are things that a suspect, who is a lawyer by the way, would never do. And I think a lot of that made this book very difficult for me to understand the thought process and like the motivations of the main character. Another thing that really disappointed me about this book is that when I read the back sleeve, it talked a lot about how it's supposed to be a courtroom drama about an old case that is now being investigated by a podcast turned documentary. Made me think that there was going to be a lot of focus on that podcast slash documentary company looking into these things, especially with like a social justice and look at race and racism, which this book was supposed to do. I think this book missed the mark in many ways when it came to those discussions, and I was not really satisfied by the conclusion and the ending and figuring out who killed who and who did what. It just didn't work out for me in the end and left me quite disappointed. So that is it for my fiction reading. Sorry to leave you on a dud. I will quickly tell you the star ratings that I gave each book because I didn't think to do this earlier. So here we go. Efrén Divided, I gave 4 stars to. Black Brother, I believe I gave 3.5 stars to. The One and Only Bob, I gave 3 stars to. Queen of the Sea, I gave 3 stars to, I want to say. The World Ends in April, I also believe I gave 3 stars to. Ghost Squad, I gave 3 stars to. Framed, I gave 3.5 stars to. Clean Getaway, I gave 4.5 stars to. Best book I read this month. And Chains, I gave 3 stars to. And then of the ones I don't have copies for, I Survived Graphic Novel, I gave 3 stars to, I believe. Echo Mountain, I gave 3.5 stars to. And Sideways Stories, I gave 4 stars to. Yes, No, Maybe So by Becky Abertali and Aisha Said, I gave 3.5 stars to, I think. And then The Holdout, I gave 2 stars to. That is all. Thank you for watching this video. If you have any comments about these books, let me know down below and I'll chat with you there. Make sure that you look at all the things in the description if you feel so inclined. And I will see you in my next video, which will be my May wrap-up nonfiction. So, hope to see you there. Bye-bye.